This is your life. That was real life, or should I say real life and death, at Arnhem 33 years ago. 1944 newsreel film. Now, I'm here tonight at Twickenham Film Studios just outside London because Sir Richard Attenborough, who's just made a film, directed a film, about that wartime airborne assault, is going to help us meet a legendary hero of that battle. He's been helping, advising on some of the sequences, and he's coming down here. The film is called A Bridge Too Far, to watch those sequences now here in the editing room of the film studios, where I'm temporarily assistant to the real editor, Tony Gibbs, here, who's also given us permission to insert an extra special scene into what's going to be watched on the movie Ola. And our man hasn't got the faintest idea what's going to come up there, so I'll get back to work and see what happens, Tony, when he comes in.
Tony, hello, son. How nice to see you again.
How are you?
Johnny, how nice to meet you. Come in the middle here, because we can...
Good, too. Here we go.
This was Grabner's, which you'll probably remember, certainly remember being shot.
General, just a moment. I know you couldn't possibly expect to see me here. We have met once before, but I want to meet you again tonight for a very special reason. Just turn around and look behind you.
If you would, so that I can say, Major General John Frost, MC, DSON Bar, hero of Arnhem and many battles besides, tonight, this is your life.
You're coming on with us, yes? Great. This is your life, John Frost, a soldier's story, but a very special kind of soldier, because this is the man who, even among the host of heroes in that great airborne battle of Arnhem, stood out for his qualities of courage and leadership. And as you discovered, Dickie, when you were making your film reconstruction of the battle, A Bridge Too Far, eh?
Absolutely. I mean, the extraordinary thing is that when you have read so much about someone, as I obviously had to read about the general, it's an amazing thing that when you meet him, his conduct and behavior is so ordinary. In fact, you have to pinch yourself to realize that you are actually standing next to a legend. And he kept us on our toes, I might say. We had to do as we were told, otherwise he got very difficult indeed. But we had a marvelous time with him, and because he had that star personality and yet that ordinary behavior, we had to find a very particular star to play him. We had to find somebody who combined that personality and who could convey the magic of Johnny Frost.
Well, earlier this evening, John, we interrupted your viewing of Sir Richard's film in that respect, so let's give you another look right now at the way you are portrayed in that picture. First, though, there are two more people very close to you who are just as eager for a preview.
Me for one, Dad.
And me for another, Johnny.
Your wife, Jean, of course, and with her, your 16-year-old son, Hugo. Hugo, you're away at school and you've seen nothing of the picture yet, so watch now for the reconstruction of that great moment in your dad's life 33 years ago when he led his paratroopers in the defense of the bridge at Arnhem.
You're late, you lazy bastard, but we'll forgive you!
That was gracious of me, don't you think?
Take cover! Bring up the piers!
Chosen to play you there is tonight in Hollywood, but if you'll watch that screen again, he talks to you now from there, Anthony Hopkins.
Hello, Eamon, and hello, General Frost. I'm sorry I can't be with you tonight, General, and I hope you recovered from your experience of filming A Bridge Too Far. It must have been quite an unnerving experience for you watching an assortment of actors like myself trying to recreate the Battle of Arnhem. I remember one day, for example, when I was playing you, I had to run across the street under German sniper fire, and doing the best job I could, I ran as fast as a bat out of hell, which is what I think I would do under the situation. You came up to me afterwards and you said, you know, I wouldn't have run as fast as that. And I asked you why, and you said, well, I refused to run under gunfire. And I tried to show a certain degree of contempt for German bullets. And I remember that, I'll never forget that. It would be easy for me to say that that is a touch of madness, but I think it's probably the most imperishable part of the human spirit, and that is the courage that you and your men showed in that awful battle. I wish you very good luck for tonight, and I hope you enjoy it. Thank you.
Thank you, Anthony Hopkins. Well, your story begins, John, at Pune in India, already with a strong military connection because your late father's a soldier serving there. Now, there are two more Frost youngsters, both girls. That's you, with your late mother and younger sister, Betty. And those sisters of yours learned very early on where your future ambitions lie, as early as when you were all together in the playroom, in fact.
That's when John used to take my toys as prisoners with his tin soldiers.
Your sister, Diana, now Mrs. Pott, and with her, your other sister, Betty, now Mrs. Pottley. So, Diana, young John was showing some skill as a warrior even then.
Yes, that's quite true, Eamon. We had a big playroom, which we all shared, and we each had a section of it. But he had a tactical advantage because he had a model railway which went right round the room. I had a peaceful little farm set in my area, and he would send his soldiers on the model railway to raid my and take them back prisoner to his territory.
Well, from those beginnings, and with a father who's a hero too, winning a military cross in the Great War as you were to do nearly 30 years later, it's no surprise that the young John Frost chooses an army career. From Sandhurst, you're commissioned as a subaltern in the Cameronians, and you see overseas service in Iraq before war breaks out. Back in England, though, it's a newly formed unit that captures your attention, the Airborne Division, then a brand new way of going to war. When you volunteered, John, did you have a good head for heights?
No, terrible head for heights.
But it's in 1942, now Major John Frost of the 2nd Parachute Battalion, that you're chosen to lead one of the most daring operations of the whole war, an airborne swoop on occupied France to capture radar equipment which is guiding enemy bombers to their targets in Britain, the place Bruneval in northern France, and at midnight on February 27, 1942, you and a small hand-picked force parachute in. As commander, you lead the jump, and as one of your NCOs lands, he sees his CO already in action.
Quite right, Eamon. He was doing a pee in the middle of the field.
From 35 years ago, another hero of Bruneval, ex-sergeant Jimmy Sharp, military medal and fire. Well, Jimmy, the CO set his man a magnificent example right through that action.
You're correct there, Eamon. But seeing his example in the middle of the field being so cool under an enemy occupied territory, a lot of us followed his example and started making little holes in the snow. The thing's got a wee bit hectic after that, didn't it, sir? Actually, we were there to bring back the parts of a German radar installation and bring them back for the boffins in this country to reassemble and find out how far advanced Germany was with radar. And this we managed to successfully do.
We managed to do it. More than that, in fact, that raid is recognized as one of the most daring and successful parachute operations ever. And we have a picture of the return from that raid. That's you, Jimmy, there, John on the bridge, and the prisoners and equipment you bring back helped the scientists to unravel the secrets of enemy radar in a way that affects the whole course of the war. But among other things, it was a triumph for Cheek, wasn't it, Jimmy?
Well, it certainly was. But there's one thing. If I was asked to do this over here again, I'd like to do it with the same comrades and with Johnny Frost in command.
Thank you, Jimmy Sharp. Thank you. For your part in the Brunnevale raid, John, you're awarded the Military Cross, and the raid becomes the first battle honor of the newly born parachute regiment. But for you, there's more action right away. Now, Lieutenant Colonel Frost and CO of the 2nd Battalion, you're ordered to North Africa. Now, there's you and your men parading for the American commander, General Eisenhower. And it's in the fighting there, one of your officers discovers that in addition to your other qualities, you have a knack of acquiring transport for the battalion.
That's because any of Johnny's men who got separated from the unit would pinch anything on wheels to get back to him.
A comrade in arms from those early days nearly 35 years ago, Lieutenant Colonel Doug Crawley, MC and Bar. Now, Dodd, you've told us that John's 2nd Battalion ended up with an embarrassing amount of transport.
Well, there was a strong rumour amongst the troops they were in that when they got out of hospital after recovering from wounds, that they were liable to be sent to a base depot. And there, from there, they might go to any ordinary infantry battalion. But, of course, this simply wasn't acceptable to any of John Frost's men. And so they made a habit of bailing out on their way to the base depot and borrowing any transport that happened to be available, truck or motorbike, and making their way back to the battalion by that means. In fact, some of them got about 500 miles from Algiers up to the front to rejoin the battalion.
He had to take some action about it, hadn't he?
Well, he then issued an order that men coming back to the battalion must not pinch transport.
Thank you, Colonel Crawley. And if you won the affection of your men in that fierce fighting in North Africa, you also won the respect of your enemy. It's in March 1943 that in one desperate battle, your depleted battalion is almost overrun. And from prisoners that you take, you learn the name of your opponents, the Witzig Regiment. Now, it's 35 years since that battle, John, but if you look at that screen, you'll see for the first time, now living near Munich in Germany, your opposing commander of the Wehrmacht Parachute Engineers, Colonel Rudolf Witzig.
We have never met, John Frost, but your name is well known to me, and also the name of your men, whom we fought in North Africa, the men who fought so fiercely that we gave them the name the Red Devils. You were one of those Red Devils, and you gave us much trouble, but you fought as fairly as you fought well. You were in the same situation with your troops as I was with mine. Always where the battles were fiercest. Now, 34 years later, we are enemies no more, and I am glad we are friends. I know that if I were to meet you in person, it would give me the greatest pleasure to shake your hand.
And you're going to meet now because the colonel is not in Germany. He's flown here to meet you for the first time. Now retired Army Colonel Rudolf Witzig. Thank you, Colonel Witzig. Of the endless dangerous days in 1943, there's one in particular that by all the odds should have ended the John Frost story most abruptly. Fighting in Tunisia, you're standing with a sergeant major by the open door of a farm building when machine gun bullets smack into the mud wall only inches away. The sergeant major dives for the doorway, but you dive in the other direction.
And thank God he did, or he wouldn't have lived to fight another day.
From